Amen, my brothers and sisters, bless the name of the Lord. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, and all that is within me. Bless his holy and righteous name. Truly, this is the day that the Lord has made. We rejoice and we are glad in it. Welcome today to the Pit Stop. Amen, our Wednesday noonday worship. We're glad that you are tuned in with us this day. For truly, God has a blessing in store for you. Join with me in a word of prayer as we invite the presence of the Lord in our space. Amen. As we shall worship him in spirit and in truth. God, we bless you. We thank you. First of all, God, we praise you just for who you are. You are our creator, you are our sustainer, you are our provider, and you are our savior. We thank you, Lord God, for this day that you have allowed us to see. You allowed us to have a good night's sleep last night and to rise early this morning. And with you on our mind, God, whereby we desire to come together, Lord God, to hear a word from you. We thank you. Bless God all that shall take place at this hour. We thank you, Lord God, for these, my brothers and sisters, who have tuned in. We pray, Lord God, for a fresh anointing of your spirit, that your word, as it goes forth, Lord God, it will accomplish what it set out to. God, bless God and keep us, God, is our prayer. We pray, God, that men, women, boys, and girls will be encouraged to continue to run on to see what the end will be. We bless you, God. We thank you. It's in Jesus' name that we ask it all. Amen. Amen. There is a little hymn that we sang, this little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. Everywhere I go, I'm gonna let it shine. So if you will, join with us as we lift up this hymn of praise. Amen. I'm gonna let it shine. Oh, this little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. Let it shine, let it shine, let it shine. Oh, everywhere I go, I'm gonna let it shine. Oh, everywhere I go, I'm gonna let it shine. Everywhere I go, I'm gonna let it shine. Let it shine, let it shine, let it shine. Well, all in my neighborhood, I'm gonna let it shine. Oh, all in my neighborhood, I'm gonna let it shine. Oh, all in my neighborhood, I'm gonna let it shine. Let it shine, let it shine, let it shine. Oh, all in my home, I'm gonna let it shine. Oh, all in my home, I'm gonna let it shine. Oh, all in my home, I'm gonna let it shine. Let it shine, let it shine, let it shine. Well, this little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. Oh, this little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. Let it shine, let it shine, let it shine. Let it shine, let it shine. shine. Amen, 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 amen. We praise God for what God, the spirit that God has invested in all of us, and our obligation to be that light to a world of darkness that lifts the Savior up for all to see. Amen. At this time, we're going to ask Deacon Staggers if he would lead us to the throne of grace. Amen.
Father God, it's just once more again, but we come as humble as we know how. Thanking you, Father, for this. We thank you, Father, for this opportunity we have right now, just to be able to call upon your holy and everlasting Christ. Father God, we just thank you for sending your angel of mercy this morning to wake us up to, Father. And Father, when you arose this morning, Father, we had a reasonable portion of health and strength. We were clothed in our right minds. Father, we was able to get up and to robe ourselves, Father. And Father, we just thank you for the blood that was still running warm in our veins. And we just want to say thank you, Lord. Father, you've been mighty good to us, Lord. You've been better to us than we have been to others. And we just want to give you the praise and the honor. We just thank you for just being here this morning, Father, to celebrate and to share with one another, Lord. And Father, we just want to give you the praise and the honor. Father God, we just pray right now if you would just bless all of our sick and our shut-in, Father, wherever they might be. Father, we pray for all of the victims of this coronavirus. Father, we just want to keep them in prayer, Father. And Father, when we have disappointed you, Father, not done the things as you've asked of us, Father, we just ask if you would just guide us back to that place of peace and trust. And Father, we want to come this morning, Father, to worship you in spirit and in truth, Lord. Father God, because we know that you are all-knowing, you're ever-present with us, and you will always be with us, Lord. And we want to thank you, Lord. We just ask you right now, Father, to order our steps, Father, that we might do the things that will be pleasing, acceptable, and honorable in our sight. Father, search our hearts and our minds, Father, and if you find things that shouldn't be there, please replace those things with peace, love, joy for one another, Father. Father, we thank you. We bless your holy and everlasting name right now, Lord. And Father God, we pray for all of the churches to be unified, Father. And we pray for our homes, Father, to be sanctuaries of peace and joy and love for one another, Lord. Father God, we want to give you all of the honor, all of the praises. And as we go through this service, bless our pastor this morning, Father. Just build him up where he might be torn down. Give him peace, Lord. And Father, we thank you. We bless your holy and everlasting name. And we give you the praise and the honor. These and all of the needful blessings, I just ask them in the precious saving name of Jesus for the forgiveness of sin. My soul says amen and amen.
Amen, amen, amen. At this time, we invite you to join with us in our scripture lesson for the morning, found in the Gospel of John, the 8th chapter, verses 1 through 11. And we're going to ask Deacon Slade if he would share in that reading.
Good morning, my Christian brothers and sisters who joined us this morning for worship. I'll be reading from the King James Version, St. John chapter 8, verses 1 through 11. Jesus went unto the Mount of Olives, and early in the morning he came again into the temple. And all the people came unto him and sat down and taught them, and he taught them. And the scribes and Pharisees brought unto him a woman taken in adultery. When they had set her in the midst, they say unto him, Master, this woman was taken in adultery in the very act. Now Moses and the law commanded us that such should be stoned. But what sayest thou? This they said, tempting him, that they might have to accuse him. But Jesus stooped down and with his finger wrote on the ground as though he heard them not. So when they continued asking him, he lifted up himself and said unto them, He that is without sin among you, let him first cast a stone at her. And again he stooped down and wrote on the ground. And they which heard it, being convicted by their own conscience, went out one by one, beginning at the eldest, even unto the last. And Jesus was left alone, and the woman standing in the midst. When Jesus had lifted up himself and saw none but the woman, he said unto her, Woman, where are those thine accusers? Have no man condemned thee? She said, No man, Lord. And Jesus said unto her, Neither do I condemn thee. Go and sin no more. The word of the Lord for the people of the Lord. Amen.
Amen. Amen. We praise God for the reading of his holy word. I encourage you, as always, as we prepare our hearts to receive the word of the Lord, that you would be in prayer, that you would pray for the preacher, that you would pray not only for the word that shall come forth, but that we also will be open to the word, that the Lord would speak to our hearts, amen, and would use this word to bless us mightily, amen. So as we prepare, there's a hymn, a familiar hymn of the church, Jesus paid it all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, but he washed it white as snow. I hear the Savior say, Thy strength in thee is small, child of weakness, watch and pray, find in me thine all and all. Jesus paid it all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow. Lord, now indeed I find thy power, and thine alone can change the leper spots and melt the heart of stone. Jesus paid it all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow. Jesus paid it all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow. In the cross, in the cross, be my glory ever, till my raptured soul shall find rest beyond the river. Jesus paid it all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, but he washed it white as snow. Amen. We are truly and eternally grateful to God, our Savior, Jesus Christ, who suffered, bled, and died that we might have life and have it more abundantly. Amen. This our scripture lesson for this early afternoon found in the gospel according to John, the 8th chapter. Hear it again from the New Living Bible translation. It reads, Jesus returned to the Mount of Olives, but early the next morning he was back again at the temple. A crowd soon gathered and he sat down and taught them. As he was speaking, the teachers of religious law and the Pharisees brought a woman who had been caught in the act of adultery. They put her in front of the crowd and said, Teacher, this woman was caught in the act of adultery. The law of Moses says to stone her. What do you say? They were trying to trap him into saying something they could use against him. But Jesus stooped down and wrote in the dust with his finger. They kept on demanding an answer, so he stood up again and said, All right, but let the one who has never sinned throw the first stone. Then he stooped down again and wrote in the dust. When the accusers heard this, they slipped away one by one, beginning with the oldest, until only Jesus was left in the middle of the crowd with the woman. Then Jesus stood up again and said to the woman, Where are your accusers? Didn't even one of them condemn you? No, Lord, she said. And Jesus said, Neither do I. Go and sin no more. I want to talk to you this morning for the few minutes that we have as we continue to move faith forward from the subject off the hook. Off the hook. There was a story told of a teenager who had a summer job working with a house painter. And he was given a 5-gallon bucket of gray paint, and he was instructed to spray the outside of the home. When he finished, he realized that the wind had carried the paint right over to the owner's beautiful red car, which was now covered with not so beautiful gray paint spots. No one was at home at the time, and every kind of thought ran through this young man's mind. Do I run away? Do I try to fix it? Do I just ignore it and hope that it will not be noticed? He decided that none of these were the right answer. So he just started praying, and when he finished, he called his boss. And when the boss got there and saw what had happened, instead of getting upset, instead of firing the young man, he just cleaned up the car. And when the owner arrived, he explained that it was all his fault. He completely took all of the blame for the mess that the boy had made. And he never condemned or ever chastised him. He just told him simply, look, he himself had been there before, but he warned him, don't let it happen again. Church, can I tell you what a relief it was for this young boy to know that he was off the hook and he was glad about it. Can I tell you, church, at some point in all of our lives, we have been ourselves in situations where we have messed up. As a matter of fact, it was clear and it was obvious and we could not deny it. Yet, because of the grace of God and Him having mercy on us, we found ourselves being let off the hook. And that's what we really see here in our text this morning, in the Word of God. In our text this morning, Jesus is in the temple teaching a crowd of folk. And the more he taught, the more people came to listen to him. However, the Jewish religious leaders of the day were not happy that Jesus was getting all this attention, perhaps attention that they wanted. So they were looking for ways to discredit Jesus and his teachings. So it was on this day that they came with a woman who had been caught in the act of adultery. And they stand her there in plain sight in front of everyone. And they say to Jesus, "Teacher, this woman was caught red-handed in the act of adultery. And Moses in the law, he gives orders to stone such a person." And they look at Jesus and say, "Now what do you say?" Here they were trying to trap Jesus into saying something incriminating so that they could bring charges against him. But now, can I tell you, they bring this woman. They bring this woman who has literally been caught in the act of adultery. There is no doubt that she did it. That's why, you know, in the text, she does not put up any defense. She does not say, "Jesus, they lying on me." She didn't try to deny it, because the Bible says, again, she was caught in the act. Amen. Now, church, can I tell you, during those days amongst the Jews, adultery was considered one of the worst possible sins one could commit. Adultery is the sin of fornication committed by someone who is married. It's a violation of the marriage bond, and according to the law of Moses, they should be stoned. But here, church, the Jewish leaders' accusation, it raises some questions for us here. First of all, it raises the question, why did they expose the woman publicly? There was no need to expose this woman publicly, and there was no need to bring her to Jesus. But it was quite clear that their intentions was not simply to expose her sin and punish her, but they were actually seeking to accuse Jesus and to question his teaching. They had an ulterior motive. Then secondly, what I don't see in the text is what happened to the brother. I mean, because the last time I checked, you know, it takes two to tangle. You can't have an adulterous relationship by yourself. And nowhere in the text is mentioned of a brother being charged right alongside this woman. If you brought the woman, then you should have brought the man too, because he's just as guilty as she was. And according to the same law, the man and the woman who committed adultery are to be stoned to death. But look here, these Jewish religious leaders were not concerned about following the law. Y'all hear me? They didn't care about really the woman at all. To them, she was just the bait to be used in an attempt to trap Jesus. And because if he says, "Forgive her," then they will be able to accuse him of going against the law. And if he said, "Stone her," then it will be a great reversal of everything he's been teaching on mercy and forgiveness of God. Now, the first thing that we see here with these religious leaders is the hypocrisy that hypocrisy leads to accusations. Let me say it again. Hypocrisy leads to accusations. And hypocrisy is pretending to be what you are not in reality. Lord, help me somebody. And it comes in a variety of forms, but the worst kind is self-righteous hypocrisy. Yeah, a self-righteous hypocrite is someone who condemns the behavior of others but engages in the same behavior himself. Yeah, in other words, as Brother Barry White says, a person who doesn't practice, but he or she preaches. So here these religious leaders, they lay their trap, they lay their bait, and they are waiting to see in reality what Jesus does. However, when you look at the text, Jesus, he reveals the hypocrisy of these leaders. In response to the accusations made against the woman, Jesus here in the text, he does a strange thing. Look at the text. The text says that he bent down and he starts to write on the ground with his finger. Instead of debating with them, or instead of tuning them out, walking away from them, he looked down and he begins to write on the ground. Now, can I tell you, the Bible doesn't say what he wrote, but he was writing something on the ground with his fingers. And as he continued, the religious leaders wouldn't stop asking Jesus, come on, Jesus, what do you have to say about this situation? And they keep on questioning him until Jesus finally gets up and says, well, let any one of you who is without sin be the first to throw a stone at this woman. And can I tell you, church, with that, Jesus shut the whole thing down. Lord have mercy. With that, all you could hear was silence. I mean, with that one statement, Jesus accomplished two things. First of all, he avoided their trap. And secondly, he exposed their hypocrisy. Jesus said that only the sinless was worthy of casting the first stone. In other words, Jesus was telling them that to go on and put your stones down. And these religious leaders wanted to have this woman stoned to death for her sins, but here Jesus made it very clear to them, it's only the only one who's worthy to condemn anyone, Lord have mercy, is the one who alone is without sin. The only one who is without sin is Jesus, and he's the only one qualified to throw some stones if some stones gonna be thrown. So here, those folk who came to condemn this woman, they ended up really condemning themselves in the act of not even casting their stone. And the message came through loud and clear. They were convicted by their own conscience. Yeah, and they walked away, the Bible says. And church, can I tell you, some of us need to be convicted by our very own conscience, because we want to hold others, Lord have mercy, to a standard that we are nowhere near in our very own lives. I know I'm not going to get an amen right there. We want to condemn others for what we see them do, but in truth of the, but if truth be told, you did the same thing last night, you just didn't get caught. All of us ought to thank God that God, instead of casting a stone at all of us, continues to offer every last one of us forgiveness. Thank you, Jesus. Here, look in the text. All of the accusers, the Bible says, when they heard Jesus, they began to go away one at a time. The oldest one first, until only Jesus was left with the woman standing there. And can I tell you, no doubt the Jewish religious leaders were troubled by what Jesus said, because they wanted to talk about the woman, but Jesus wanted to talk about them. That's why Jesus didn't say, let her be stoned. He said, let any of you who is without sin be the first one to throw a stone. There's a big difference. Jesus knew that the real issue wasn't the woman, but the real issue was the hypocrisy of those Jewish leaders. So, and my brothers and sisters, what I'm trying to tell you this morning is that we all have the tendency to point our fingers at others, but the Bible tells us over there, he said, the Bible tells us, how can you say to your brother, let me take out that little speck in your eye, when you yourself fail to see the big old plank that's in your very own eye? The Bible says, you hypocrites, you first take the plank out of your own eye, then you'll be able to see clearly to remove the little speck from your brother's eye. And I tell you that we all need to be careful in pointing our fingers at others, especially when someone commits a wrong, because it's easy for us to criticize and condemn them, but let us not be so quick to accuse others. Instead, follow the model of Jesus. You need to pray for folk, yeah. We need to pray, always pray for folk, yeah. And not only pray for folk, but show folk some love and compassion. That's what Jesus did, even on the cross. Instead of condemning those who were crucifying him, Jesus said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. And church, can I tell you, it's not always easy to do, but that's what God wants us to do. There is a saying that I know most of you have heard before. To err is human, but to forgive is divine. But the question is, how often do we practice that? Then, the second thing that we see in the passage is that forgiveness leads to freedom. In verse 10, Jesus, he straightens up and he ask the woman, where are your accusers? He says, has anyone condemned you? And she says, no, they gone. No, nobody's here. And Jesus tells her, then neither do I condemn you. But I love the second part. You can't leave, you can't finish with the first part. You got to finish with the second part. Jesus says, neither do I condemn you. Go and sin no more. Jesus did not condemn the woman. And why, you might ask? I mean, come on, let's be real. I mean, in all actuality, the woman was guilty. But Jesus did not condemn her, because God's purpose is not to condemn us. That's why John 3:16 declares, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believes in him shall not perish, but shall have eternal life. And don't stop at 16, go to 17. For God did not send his son into the world to condemn the world, but hallelujah, but that the world through him might be saved. Can I tell you this morning, God's purpose is not to condemn sinners. If that was the case, if that was God's purpose, was to condemn sinners, then Jesus would have never came to die for all of us who were lost. But it's because he did it, the Bible says, that there is now no condemnation for those of us who are in Christ. I feel a shout coming on. Yeah, his purpose is not to condemn us, but to forgive and to save sinners. Matter of fact, that's what the word, he tells us in his word. It's not my will that any would perish, but that all all everybody will come into the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. That's why Jesus treated this woman so differently compared to these religious leaders. They condemned and threatened to stone her, but Jesus did not condemn her. Instead, he let her off the hook. And Lord have mercy. Jesus did not condemn her to death, nor did he say to her that her adulterous deeds were no longer a sin. And y'all need to hear me. Don't think that because he didn't condemn her that he condoned what she did. No. That's not what's happening. No, because he openly revealed her sin when he told her to leave her life of sin. In other words, what Jesus here is saying, I know what you did, and you know what you did. But because I'm forgiving you, I'm giving you another chance. So now you go and don't you do it again. That's a word for somebody out there listening to me. Yeah, thank God for Jesus' forgiveness. And he tells us, yes, he offers us forgiveness, but he also tells us, go and don't do it again. Jesus, again, was not making light of her sin, but he was giving her another chance. And we all ought to be thankful to God for another chance, because all of us ought to be grateful to God, especially in light of the fact that you know what you've done. And not only do you know what you've done, God knows what you've done. But instead of casting us aside, instead of a stone you, God says to us, I forgive you, now go and sin no more. Here, church, Jesus clearly points out that the woman had messed up by committing adultery, but he lets her go because he forgave her, and he tells her to go and sin no more. And I'm glad about that, because when Jesus asked the woman to leave her life of sin, hear me now, he was not expecting her to become sinless or to become perfect. Let me say that again. When he asked the woman to leave her life of sin, he was not expecting her to become sinless or perfect. What he was telling her was to stop making sin the habit of her life and not to go on sinning. That's my word for you this morning. Don't keep doing what the word of God tells you is wrong. In other words, Jesus is basically drawing a line in the sand between her past and her future. He forgave her sin and ask her to live now a life of holiness. Likewise, Jesus, he forgives our past sins, but he also expects you and I not to continue in the habitual acts of sin in the future. And my brothers and sisters, Jesus' forgiveness leads to our freedom from the bondage of sin. So this morning, as we see that how Jesus forgave this adulterous woman, let us take some time to really examine ourselves. We all are represented somewhere in this story. You may be like the woman, condemned by everyone and standing in the need of forgiveness. Or you might be like those Jewish religious leaders accusing others but unable to see your own need. Help me, Holy Ghost. So the question that we must all ask ourselves, is there something for which I need forgiveness? Yes, the Bible says we all have sinned and we all fallen short of the glory of God. We have to ask ourselves, am I living a life of habitual habitual sin right now? Is there something that I need to leave behind in my life? Is there somebody that I need to forgive? Well, my brothers and sisters, as we have been forgiven by Jesus, let us likewise forgive like Jesus. Because I cannot tell you that the only one who had the right to throw a stone that day never picked one up. God, we bless you. We thank you for your word. We thank you, God, for reminding us this day, Lord God, of how you continue to look beyond our every fault and see our needs. We thank you, Lord God, because we are not perfect, God. We realize, God, that we have fallen short of your glory. We realize, God, that we have done things that we should not have done. We have left stuff undone that we should have done. We thank you, Lord God, that you offer us all forgiveness. You say in your word that if we come to you, God, that you are and confess our shortcomings, that you are faithful, you are just to forgive us and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. We thank you. Lord God, bless all who are tuned into this broadcast. And God, perhaps there's someone who heard this message, God, who realizes their very own need of forgiveness. We thank you, God, that you offer forgiveness to all of us. And as your word declares, as I just stated, if we come to you confessing our shortcomings, if we come to you, God, you are faithful to forgive us. So, God, continue to draw us all nearer to you. Continue, Lord God, to bring us to you, Lord God, for those who don't know you, in the pardon of our sins, God, we pray that, Lord God, that we will confess with our mouth and believe in our heart that you raised Jesus from the dead, and you say in your word, if we do that, verily we shall be saved. We thank you, and we thank you that today's a good day to get saved. God, then we lift up, God, every concern before you. We lift up our nation, our world, this pandemic, all that we are enduring right now, the loss of life, God. We lift up families of comfort in the name of Jesus. We lift up Sister Pat Robinson, Lord God, and the Robinson family, God. We lift up the Mary and King families, the Gowdy family, God. Continue to lift up Brother Kenneth and Sister Juanita, God, and their loss. We lift up the Hunt family continuously, God, the Costa family, God. You know about us all, God. We lift up every name, God, that's mentioned on our sick list, God. We lift up those who are even on our line now, God, they're requesting prayer. We lift up Sister Lewis. We lift up Sister Mary, Alfreda Murray. We lift up Sister Carolyn, Carrie, God. We lift up Brother Millie, God. We lift up Brother Chris. We lift up Sister Wanda, the Rose family, Frank Sherrod, the Broadest family, the Durham family, the Wood family, God. We lift up my Sister Mary Miller, God, to you in the name of Jesus. We thank you. Continue to bless Brother Kelly, God, Willie Kelly. Continue to bless Tyrone Johnson, Dexter Jernigan, the Chase family, God. Continue to comfort them, to bless them. We lift up Sister Artis, God, Brother Chester Parks, Sister Margaret Brown, Sister Deborah Wallace, Charlene Williams, and Cornelius Presley. Continue to lift up Brother Sean and the Lindsay family, God. Lift up Sister Beverly Parker and Sister Daquanae Townsend, God. We lift up Brother Antoine and the Harrell family, God, in the passing of his dad. Continue to comfort and give him strength. Brother DeMarco and the Jones family, continue, God, to speak peace and comfort and healing, God, on his brother DeMarco in the name of Jesus. We continue to pray your strength upon the Garrison family, God, the Brooks family. Bless Kenneth Jenkins. We thank you for the praise report, God, that he is now home. Continue to strengthen, God, the Hunter family, Richard Winstead, the Slade family, and Sister Faye, the Scott family. We thank you, Lord God, for what you're doing in the lives of your people. We lift up Sister Barbara Blunt, Sister Karen Love, continue to lift up the Davises, Sister Betty and Sylvester, the Hesters, Alfreda and Mike. We lift up, God, the Spearmans, Reverend and Sister Spearman, Pastor Emeritus and Sister Austin, God. We lift up Sister Green, Sister Edna Ward, Sister Munlin, God. We lift up, God, Andrea Parson, Jeanette Wright, the Brother Tori Carter, Jocelyn and Warren Fletchers, the Galloways. Thank you for Sister Marjorie. Thank you for Brother Joe. Thank you for Sister Laura, God. Continue to strengthen them. Thank you for Brother Oliver. Continue, God, to raise him up. Continue to strengthen his body, mind, and spirit. Bless Brother Lyons, God, in the name of Jesus. You know where he is right now. You know what his struggles. We thank you, Lord God, that no one, none of us are out of your reach, God. Continue to bless Sister Mildred Harrell, Sister Raper, God. Continue to bless and strengthen Brother Alonzo Brown and Sister Delilah Holmes, my sister, in the name of Jesus. Bless Sister Katie, Sister Mildred, Mary Harrell, Sister Mama Louise King, God, Sister Harvey, Sister Helen Walker, Sister Bertha Morgan. And we thank you, Lord God, for Sister Taylor, Sister Madeline Taylor, God, who just on yesterday celebrated 92 years. Continue, Lord God, to strengthen and keep her. Continue, Lord, keep your loving arms around. We thank you, God, for who you are in all of our lives. The fact that we can call on you morning, noon, and night. You're never too busy to come and see about us. God, bless this nation. Bless this world in which we live. God, we can't pray enough for the leadership. God, bless this president, Lord God, and all those who are in leadership, the positions making leadership. Lord God, guide their feet, order their steps in the name of Jesus. Lord God, work in spite of them, Lord God. Bless God these states that are opening back up, these businesses. Help us, God, to, first of all, to trust you, God, and to operate not only in faith, but to operate in godly wisdom. God, continue to keep your loving arms of protection around us as you have. And God, bless churches everywhere, Lord God, that over the next few weeks, Lord God, decisions that will be made, Lord God, will be made, God, again, Lord God, after careful seeking of you. We thank you, Lord God. We pray, Lord God, that we are all guided by your hand. In the name of Jesus, we pray and ask it all. Amen. 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 We have done as we have been commanded, yet there is more to do. We praise God for his holy word and what he opens up to us through it. Amen. Even on 12 o'clock at Wednesday noonday, even in your house, amen, you have the opportunity, amen, to be able to continue worshiping through giving, amen, through our Easy Tithe giving app, amen. And we bless God and thank all of those who continue to come out on Sunday morning, dropping off your gifts, your tithes, your offerings, and dropping off those non-perishable food items on Sunday morning and on Tuesday. Again, that we still have a good supply of things, of food on hand. So stop on by Sunday morning between 9:30 and 10:30, quarter of, so that you can get back and be able to view, be a part of worship online. Stop by on Sunday morning and pick it up. Also, our prayer call, we thank all of you who joined us last night on our 6 p.m. prayer call, and we invite you to join us on tomorrow. This coming weekend, I will shoot out a notice that we are going to move from this conference call number. I will issue out a new conference call number this weekend, so that on next Tuesday, we'll utilize our new service. So I will send it out in a text blast. I will also send it out in a phone and email blast as well, and we'll post it on our Facebook page and our website, so that everyone can have our new login number. As a matter of fact, as you see on the screen now, that is the new number along with the passcode. So you can take that number there. Tomorrow we will continue, and Sunday we will continue to use our current number. But the number that is listed here now is the number that we'll use beginning next Tuesday, 1-872-240-3212, and the passcode 164-695-965. Again, we'll use that passcode not this week, but beginning next Tuesday evening. Amen. Also, we invite you to join us for worship on Sunday morning at 11 a.m. Amen. Amen. We bless and we praise God. Also, as you continue to listen to the news updates, there are many states that are beginning to open and release restrictions. DC has not. Prince George's County has not to this point. I will also within the next week or so shoot out our plan to reoccupy our building, and it will be in stages. So I'll let you know now, no matter when DC opens up, whatever date they give, we're still just not going to just rush back in. We'll do it in stages, following the procedures. And also, as many of you are aware, we normally, during this time of year, in the next week, right after Memorial Day, we would normally go into our summer schedule, because where we have one service at 10 a.m. But because of the situation where we are, we're not going to go to one service. We will continue to have two so that we can accommodate individuals safely moving forward. So we'll have two services. I'll shoot that as well. We're gonna modify our hours. We won't do 8 o'clock in the morning and 11. Prayerfully, we will do 10 and 12. Amen. Amen. So we'll modify those services. But look forward, like I say, your emails over the next week or so. I'll send all of that information out along with our plan to reoccupy the building. Amen. To God be the glory. Again, we have done all we have been commanded to do, but yet there is still more to do. So as we you heard our prayer list. There are a lot of persons on our prayer list. Some are sick. Some just mentioned to pray for me. There are others who have suffered loss. There are those who are going in for testing. And so we want to continue to pray. Continue to even to pray for Sister Fanny Barksdale and my brother Chris. Amen. I mentioned the fact that Sister Madeline Taylor celebrated her birthday yesterday, but we give a shout out to our youth director, Sister Fanny, who also celebrated her birthday on yesterday, and to all of our congregants who have May birthdays, amen. We give a shout out to you on today. So as we prepare our hearts to close today, we want to be in prayer. We want to be in prayer. So we're going to ask Deaconess Moore if she would lead us in the throne, to the throne of grace. And for those who are on our page now, if you have prayer requests, you can go ahead and type them in as Sister Donna prays. I'm going to be praying as well for your prayer requests. And I see them in real time. So if you request special prayer, go ahead and just type it in, and we'll be praying. Amen.
Trials are on every hand, and we do not understand all the ways that God will lead us to this blessed promised land. But we wonder why the tests, when we try to do our best. for we will understand it better by and by. Father God, we come to your throne once again, for you are the one who sits high and rich, Lord God. You are the one that created us in your very being. You are the one that knows the number of hairs on our heads, Lord God. And only you, Lord God, the great creator, you know our very being and our very existence, Lord God. Father God, we come at this time, Lord God, because our sick list is very long, Lord God, for Emmanuel Baptist Church. And our bereavement list is also growing, Lord God. But Father God, we know that you are the God of all gods. You are Alpha and you are Omega. You make no mistakes, Lord God. We know that you do everything in decency and in order, Lord God. And Father God, I thank you for the great word that we heard on this day. Off the hook, Lord God. We thank you, Lord God, that we were not consumed as we were out there in the world doing everything that we could do. That you spared our golden moments to just roll on just a little while longer. And we say thank you for that, Lord God. Father God, we are just praying right now in the name of Jesus that you just have your way as we're dealing with this pandemic, Lord God. There are those, Lord God, that have recovered, and we thank you for that, Lord God. And Father God, we know that there are many that are on the ban of affliction, Lord God, and there are those that are locked up in the laws of circumstances, Lord God. But I pray right now in the name of Jesus, Lord God, that you just walk by. Let them touch the hem of your garment, Lord God. Let them be healed. Let them be made whole, if it is your holy, divine, perfect will. Father God, because we know it's because of you sending your divine Son into this world to take on the sins that we all committed, Lord God. And we know, Lord God, that we are not consumed because of the blood of Jesus. And we thank you, Lord God, because you're feeling love. The love fails not, Lord God. We just thank you because Jesus paid a debt that none of us could ever pay. We could not take on the stripes that he did, Lord God. And I just thank you, Lord God. I thank you for forgiveness. And Lord God, I pray right now that as we get ready to this broadcast, that you will cast whatever thoughts we might have said, whatever thoughts we might have done, whatever deeds we have done, Lord, that is against you, that you will cast it into the sea of forgiveness, that it will not rise up against us on the day of judgment. We thank you, Lord God, for our cancer, how you have given him the vision, Lord God, to bring Emmanuel forward, Lord God. And we thank you for that, Lord God, because it's not by happenstance. We thank you, Lord God, that continue to bless and keep everyone, Lord God, that has said, pray for me. I need prayer. I need prayer for a family member. I need prayer, Lord God, because prayer is what's going to bring us throughout all of this, Lord God. Bless the current government. Bless President Trump, Lord God, because you put him in office to keep us from praying unto you. We thank you, Lord God. We just thank you. We couldn't bless you enough, Lord God. I can't praise you enough. So, Father God, I'm thanking you on bended knees right now, saying thank you. Lord God, I love you. We magnify you. We glorify you. We can't do anything without you. Father God, we ask this prayer in Jesus' name with the forgiveness of sin. Our soul says amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Thank you, Sister Donna, and thank all of you. I see all the prayer requests that are coming through, and we're praying for you. We're praying for healing. We're praying for those who have tested positive. We're praying. I see your request. We're praying for jobs. I see your request, and we believe that God is going to answer those prayers. God's going to answer those prayers. So God bless you. May heaven smile upon you until we gather this way again. May his peace be with you. Amen.